time, I'll call the meeting of the Marshall City Council to order with the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to welcome everyone here this evening. We do have an agenda before us. Are there any changes to that agenda? If not, we'll operate under that agenda. We'll move then to agenda item number three. Agenda item number three would... Okay, there we go. Agenda item number three is consider the approval of the minutes of the last regular meeting that was held on August 8, 2016, as well as a work session that was also held on August 30th, 2016. So the council does have the minutes of both of those meetings. Are there any corrections to note at this time?
Move the minutes.
I'll second.
Motion by Larry, seconded by John to approve the minutes as they have been presented. We'll move to a vote. That motion does pass. Once again, I apologize for the technology switch there. So we'll now move then to agenda item number four. This is a public hearing. This is a public hearing regarding the adoption of the ordinance related to the small house restriction ordinance. We will open the public hearing. Following the public hearing, we will then consider the ordinance, discuss the public hearing. So I'll call on Glenn Olson, Director of Public Works, City Engineer, to conduct this public hearing. Glenn will make a brief presentation. Following that, we'll take any public comment. Glenn?
Thank you, Mayor and Council. As you've seen on the on TV recently, kind of a direction towards tiny houses. Tiny houses are just very small houses, and their intent is that you don't have a big investment in it, and you use that money that you would have made an investment in a larger house for other purposes in life. And in our discussions, it became evident that we didn't have any regulation concerning the size of single family or housing in all of the residential districts that would be affected by that tiny house direction. So in the discussions with staff and with the Planning Commission, we came up with the recommendation that we would restrict the construction of the residential type homes for what we call tiny houses to 500 square feet and less. We had originally talked about 700 square feet because that seemed like a fairly small home to live in, but we did find that we have several homes in the city that were less than 700 square feet. So we took a look at the 500 square foot restriction. We still would allow the tiny houses to be built in the manufactured home district, the R5 district, but the normal residential subdivisions like the R1 through R4, they would be restricted to something greater than 500 square feet. You can take a look at the memo that concerns kind of the discussions that we had. One of the questions was is that we also require the minimum dimension of the home to be 24 feet. The reason for that is we didn't want homes to look like manufactured homes. And I won't say manufactured homes, it should say like trailer houses or like a garage in a single family or in a residential neighborhood. So if you take the 24 foot minimum dimension and you assume that it's 24 feet each direction, that would equal 576 square feet. Well, the reason that we say that 24 feet in any direction is because you could make an L-shaped house out of it and not be a 24-foot square. So even if you had 24 feet in two directions, we still wanted to have the 500-square-foot minimum. I think we'll leave it at that. If there's any questions, we want to make sure that we would allow that type of construction in the city if somebody would want to initiate a home of that size, but the manufactured home district would be the location where we would allow that.
Thank you, Glenn. This was also discussed at Legislative and Ordinance Committee, I believe, as well as recommended by the League of Minnesota Cities. So I'll open it up now for public comment, either from anyone here in the audience or from the City Council. Is there any input as part of the public hearing, Larry?
Glenn, this would be one home per lot?
Yes, it would be one home per lot. You could have other accessory buildings. You can have up to two accessory buildings on any residential lot as well. But for the main living structure, that would be the minimum size.
So my understanding is, if we had a lot, say, for example, out in Parkway Addition, I could not put this house out there?
You could not.
The only place I can put it is like in a
manufactured home park.
What's manufactured home? Like a trailer house?
Yes. Or it's a manufactured home too. So generally the connotation of a trailer house is not what the owner of a manufactured home park would like you to think of it as. See, a manufactured home park would allow the types of homes with wheels on that are brought in and dropped off. This is intended not to have wheels.
I understand it, but I don't think that you would find a house of this type built out there because they don't have a foundation.
We have some immediately adjacent to the mm-hmm. Parkway Addition, and that's really where we came up with the 500 square foot minimums, is that's the type of housing that was, and in that area there, it seemed to work fine.
I guess I personally think we're over-regulating when we say that if I have a normal lot that I can't put this house on it, if I have a normal size lot.
You can put a home that's 500 square feet or more on that lot.
For example, in Parkway 2?
Yes. More than 500 yeah. square feet. Yes, you so, can.
Okay, so then I guess I did not understand.
Not less than 500 yeah. square feet.
Okay.
You couldn't in Parkway 2.
If it's more than 500 square feet, I can put it on that.
Yes, you can.
Thank you for straightening me out.
Okay.
Other input as part of the public hearing, John?
Yeah, and then just again for clarification, this is a permanent dwelling. It's not on wheels.
It is not.
This is a structure that may or may not have a basement.
That's correct.
Question. Glenn, I'm looking at the zoning categories of R1 through 4, and I'm looking at our zoning map, and I can't quite make out the resolution. Is the manufactured home neighborhood immediately south of 23, is that a different zoning classification?
That is R5.
It's R5. That's what I was wondering.
That's so correct.
By default, this could happen in R5,
yes.
But it's excluded from 1 through 4.
That's correct.
Thank you.
Any other input as part of the public hearing?
Just to make sure that I'm clear on this, so if it's over 500 square feet and it meets the two walls having a minimum of 24-foot dimension, then it's not a small or a tiny house.
That's
the tiny house could be built, like you see it on TV, on a 9-foot or 8.5-foot wide by 35-foot long trailer chassis built up, and then that can go to the R5, the manufactured home zone, and be set up that way.
It would have to be 24 feet in each direction. Okay, so it could be L-shaped, but it could be still up to 500 square feet.
Up to 500?
Yeah, for a tiny house.
For a tiny house, okay.
Hey, other input? Is there any other input from the audience as part of the public hearing? If not, I'd entertain a motion to close this public hearing.
So move.
Second.
Motion by Larry, seconded by Craig. Discussion? If not, we'll move to a vote. Motion passes. We'll now consider the ordinance. Are there questions about the ordinance as it is prepared?
I'll move the ordinance.
Motion Motion by Larry, seconded by David. Discussion? Now we'll move to a vote. Motion passes. Move then to agenda item number 5. Agenda item number 5 is the consent agenda. We'll bring the items up on the screen on the that are on the consent agenda this evening. On the consent agenda would be consider the approval of the transient merchant license for Linnaeus Jones. Consider the approval of a transient merchant license for Austin Bell Pixler. Consider the authorization to declare vehicles as surplus property for the from the police department. Consider the approval of the employee deferred compensation program vendor. Consider the exempt permit for the Minnesota chapter of National Wild Turkey Federation / Buffalo Ridge Gobblers for an event on October 8, 2016. And consider the approval of the bills and the project payment. So is there any item on the consent agenda any member of the council wants removed for purposes of a separate discussion? If not, is there a motion to approve the items on the consent agenda?
So moved.
Second. Motion by Craig, seconded by John. Discussion? If not, we'll move to a vote.
I just had a question here. Ed, look, aren't these permits they need
for each person?
For each person?
Yeah. Motion passes. Before we move to agenda, the next agenda item, just a quick sound check. Are the microphones working this evening? Okay, so you can hear okay. Then we'll move then to agenda item number 12. Agenda item number 12, consider the approval of the Minnesota Municipal Utilities Association service agreement for the safety management program for services for 2017. With us tonight is our human resource director, Sheila Dubs. Sheila?
Thank you, Mayor and Council. This is a renewal agreement from MMUA. They've been providing us with safety services since the year 2000. They do our training, our OSHA compliance, as well as our consultation with departments. We have a representative that comes out 2 times a month for full days and provides our trainings directly to our employees, which are taped for those that miss it. And then they also go and visit with departments and employees. They review our accidents and injuries. They also sit as a part of our safety committee and guide direction on that as well. So we're asking for a renewal of this contract. We've been very satisfied with their services. I would certainly entertain any questions that you have about their services if you'd like. In the cost breakdown, it does list, we do pay them on a quarterly basis, and it is broken out by the number of employees within each department. That's how it's allocated.
Thank you, Sheila. Are there any questions?
Sheila, is this contract for 1 year or is it longer?
It is for 1 year.
Any other questions?
I move the recommendation.
Second.
Motion by Larry, seconded by Craig. Discussion? If there's no discussion, we'll move to a vote. Motion passes. Agenda item number 13. Agenda item number 13, consider the amendment to the Red Baron Arena and Expo staffing structure. This was a recommended change to the organizational structure that we had adopted last year. Sheila?
That's correct. Thank you. On March 8th and March 22nd, respectively, the council approved a staffing restructure that included multiple departments. At that time, it was Parks, Public Ways, and the Finance Administration departments. The Red Baron Arena and Expo had not been opened yet. On June 7th, we began use of that facility by the public. There are a variety of activities scheduled there on a daily basis. I've listed a few of those in your background materials. We're also expecting the field complex to be open in May of 2017. With the current staffing model, we included 3 positions that were approved and budgeted to facilitate the maintenance operations at the arena. That included our facility maintenance supervisor, our maintenance technician, and a building custodian. We have hired 2 of those staff people. We hired the supervisor, and we hired the technician position. The custodial position vacancy was advertised, and we received 7 applications. After reviewing those, the park superintendent and I opted to wait on the custodial hire until the supervisor and the technician positions were trained in, and that also allowed us to better determine the needs of the facility. In lieu of hiring the full-time employee, we did bring on a temporary employee for 2 months to fill those duties. And then Preston and I got together and talked, and we are proposing to hire 1 additional technician position in lieu of the custodial position at this time. On your attached organizational structure, it's the position in yellow. There's no addition of a staff person. It is basically an exchange of a technician position for the custodial position. I did provide the job descriptions in your background if you have any questions on that. Both Preston Sensrud and Scott Vandermillen are here tonight to answer any questions about the operations of the facility. We believe that the exchange of those 2 positions will help with the efficiency of operations there, as well as a reduction in overtime costs. The facility operates from 7 in the morning until 11 at night with activities not always on a daily basis, but on occasions, and it's very difficult to staff that with the current structure and still maintain the operations at the facility. We did review this with the personnel committee on Friday, and they also recommended to proceed forward with staff's recommendation. So I would certainly entertain any questions that you have, and we can call Preston or Scott up too if you have questions about the operations that I can't answer.
Okay, thank you. Is there are there comments on the recommendation from the personnel committee?
I dig it. Like Sheila said, we met last Friday and looked over the options and reviewed the cost savings that we feel we would have if we hired a technician versus a custodian, due to the fact that we have to have some type of supervision there, which would be either the superintendent or the supervisor we have. If we do that, last week alone, they had about 20 hours of overtime for that weekend. So if you start looking at the difference between what we pay a custodian and a technician versus the overtime, the least expensive route for us to go would be to hire the technician, and then we can subsidize that with part-time labor, whatever we need to clean and keep the arena clean like it needs to be.
Okay. Thank you, Larry. Other input or questions?
So the custodian position's gone then and replaced with the maintenance technician, is that?
That's what we're proposing.
And so it looks like the 3 positions that are budgeted are $160,000 every year for the 3 positions for that?
That was what was budgeted for 2016. When we spoke with the personnel committee, we also recognized that this is our immediate staffing structure. As the facility gets more use, as it gets busier, we may well need to enhance the positions that are there. But this was the base level of needs that we felt were right in order to get the scheduling and the use off the ground.
It appears that for at least 6 of the 12 months when the both sheets of ice are in, it's reasonable to assume that it's going to be operating from, other than during the school day, it's going to operate on the weekends and the holidays at a minimum of 7 to 11 o'clock at night. And, you know, as we start looking at this, and we did map the hours like Sheila described and Larry also confirmed, we started looking at the hours and the overlay and what's required to be out there to maintain that operation, to keep it safe, and also to keep it with, you know, full-time oversight. Those 3 positions are really going to be a minimum. You know, it's the minimum we're going to be able to staff with.
Thank you. Other input, other questions? John?
Just a comment on that as well. As far as this year, since there is a delay in bringing this person in, there is a savings according to the budget, but just kind of be advised or whatever that does hit us the next year, when we just have to work that into the budget as well. And like Sheila mentioned, we did have some of the discussion that as the facility gets more and more used, it's very possible that we could use a custodian in that position, and whether that's a part-time or a full-time, that's just things that we will have to work our way into and find out as we progress along and we get the system busier and more use. But one of the other things we talked about, this is a new facility, it's in good condition, and we want to make sure it stays that way.
I have just two comments here. On the job description, it talks about supervision received, and it talks about the supervision for the maintenance technician as being the lead maintenance supervisor. Is that supposed to say the facility maintenance supervisor?
It should. That is an error. Thank you. I will correct that.
If you look at the difference in salary between the building custodian and a maintenance technician, the maintenance technician's making about twice per hour what the custodian is. This is a new venture for us as far as the operation of the new facility. Wouldn't it make sense to maybe see how things go as far as what we need and what the hours are going to be before we have permanent positions here? And wouldn't it be easier maybe to upgrade the position from building custodian to maintenance technician later on, rather than going the other way and getting rid of a maintenance technician and replacing it with a building custodian? Right now we don't have a track record as to hours for the entire year as to what we're going to need, and wouldn't it be safer to start the other way instead?
I can certainly let Preston speak to that as well, but from my understanding, the second maintenance technician is needed in order to continue with the operations of the center with the existing activities that are working in there.
Anything you want to add to that, Preston?
Thank you, Mayor and Council. What I would add is during the summer, currently in our non-peak times, both the employees out there are working 55 to 60 hours a week, and we're not even keeping the facility as clean as we'd like to. Come winter, when we have, like Councilman Schaefer mentioned, we have practices starting at right after school and going till 11 at night. I don't feel comfortable having the custodian being there on the weekends, overseeing the boilers and all their handling equipment. And we have a lot of money invested in that equipment to make sure we have somebody qualified being there and being in charge. So I think it is a, like I say, about double in pay, but I think for the dollars we have invested in the equipment, it's a good investment for us in the moving forward. So
it sounds like they're busy the way it is. Is two maintenance technicians going to be enough in the long run? Are you going to end up hiring another one?
That, I guess, like I say, based on if we're full all the time and we see that we need another person, I think that would be a good problem to have. That means we're utilizing the facility as we intended, and it's full. I mean, that's going to be a big benefit to Marshall if that's full like that and we are short on help. So,
and that'll be probably a future discussion, because then that will also, we'll need to consider the additional revenue that would come with that busier schedule, so increased usage. Larry?
Darren, I'm going to call you on the carpet right now. How many tournaments we got scheduled between now and the first of the year? Three?
Between just the levels, there will be four, but each weekend of those levels, there's two on each weekend, so it's a total of eight. Plus, we have two state tournaments coming, so that's...
But those will be after the first of the year?
Yes.
The state tournament. So,
and we have a Thanksgiving tournament with high school. Also.
That's my point. Now, you know, if we got those five weekends in scheduled full already, that'll almost offset the cost between the custodian and the technician alone now, because of, again, we're going to be looking at another 60 hours a week in overtime.
Right.
When we talked about this at the personnel committee meeting, one of the things is, as we tried to lay out how the schedule fits, and in having three that are capable of being there by them, you know, basically as the lead staff person there, we certainly anticipate having a number of part-time staff that are trained and qualified to do the actual ice operations, running the Zamboni, taking care of the basic upkeep and kind of troubleshooting for the teams, locker room issues, and the concession areas. But to have somebody there that's qualified to actually run the bigger, highly technical, mechanical parts of the facility, I think is why we really felt that we need to approve or recommend that we maintain a presence of full-time city staff that are qualified in all the aspects of the facility. That's why we recommend it. And Glenn, I think you're right. I think we're probably, I don't see us taking a technician and moving them back to a custodian. I would see us not too far in the future, probably considering a third technician and a custodian as it rolls out. It would not surprise me at all before the end of this year to be looking and considering those types of additions.
Craig, other input questions?
I'm going to move the recommendation.
Motion by Larry. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Craig. Discussion? If not, we'll move to a vote. Motion passes. Agenda item number 14. Agenda item number 14 is consider entering into the wastewater treatment facility leachate agreement with Lyon County. Glenn, you'll start this, and also Bob Van Moore is here if there's any questions. Glenn?
Thank you, Mayor and Council. As you can see in the memorandum, this is an ongoing agreement that we would have with Lyon County. Lyon County operates the landfill and has leachate that they need to get rid of to treat. Right now, it had been going to Sioux Falls, and this would save them a considerable amount of money taking it here. Bob has already taken a look at what the quality of the leachate is and expects to be able to handle it at our wastewater facility with no issue. We also in the agreement, if we at any time want to terminate the agreement, we can. Bob, any other comments or concerning the leachate itself or our ability to accept it? And then I wanted to have Dennis weigh in on any of the issues that may be involved with the legal end.
Thank you. This is a current agreement that we have with Lyon County. It was originally in 1995 we drafted that one up. I had some concerns with it because some of the testing parameters were so low that they can't even physically test for them at those levels. So I was approached by Lyon County to see if we would retake it again, and I was working with MPCA, worked with our engineering consultants, Bolton and Mink, and none of the issues of the pollutants of concern are going to be an issue for us. Very, very tight testing limits and just a very comprehensive list of everything that we test for. So
Bob, why did the arrangement go away and then now it's coming back?
I just felt uncomfortable with some of those limits. I wanted to make sure that we were staying in compliance with our MPCA agreement, and at that point we couldn't even test to the levels they were asking us to test for in that original agreement. So.
And so now we are able to do the testing ourselves, or does any of this have to be sent off?
We send everything off, actually. Lyon County is responsible for the sampling and testing and then reporting back to us. So, yep. Okay.
Yep. Larry?
Bob, a couple questions. The discharge is going to be monitored when it comes in or tested, and then it's going to go through a treatment plant, and our discharge from there will be tested to make sure that we've removed.
No, there's different sampling periods. Some of this testing is done annually, some is done monthly, some is done quarterly. They sample according to that schedule, and it'll carry for that quarter. So there would be potential if something would really change drastically in between sampling periods, but not likely. They have a large leachate pond that they collect everything into, and then they just do their sampling out of that at the recommended periods.
And then they'll truck that to your treatment
plant?
Yes,
they keep track of the truckloads coming in. We're limiting them to 3 truckloads a day maximum.
Greg?
Have you received leachate from them in the past?
We have, yes.
And there's no tangible impacts to your the metals concentration or anything in your biosolids?
Nope, everything is real low concentrations. You know, it's the type of waste that they have. We don't have heavy metals or anything like that. It's pretty standard landfill material. So,
okay. Any other questions?
And then, so,
oh, go ahead.
What are the consequences if we exceed the limits?
If they exceed their limits, we just cut them off.
But we
don't normally test for those parameters. We do, and depending on our permit, sometimes three times in a life our permit, we will be testing for the priority pollutants down to the levels that they're talking about. So it's on their shoulders to be testing to the levels right. To make sure it's clean prior to dumping.
But if it causes us to exceed the limits, are there state fines that we have to worry about?
I believe in the contract that there would still be liable for any violations, according to us. It's not, you know, we're not exempting them from any violations of polluting, so.
Part of the review process on this, you talked about conversations with the Minnesota Pollution Control Agency. You and the county have discussed with them on the pretreatment part where the agency has confirmed that they don't anticipate any pass-through interference with the facility, correct? That's part of their review and approval process?
Yes, that's typical of what the agreement would be from an approval from MPCA.
Dennis, you have
a... Yes, I don't have any concerns legally. I was just concerned as to the testing, the limits, and if you have a comfort level MPCA, your consultants have a comfort level with those various components that are tested for.
I can
remember years and years ago we have a molybdenum, or however you say that problem.
Yep.
That's prohibited by the contract, so that,
yep.
And that
yep.
caught my attention, so
okay. Yep. Yeah. No, there was nothing in there, and even when you were accepting it earlier in the 90s, that there was no violations. It's just that to me the language wasn't straightforward, and I just didn't feel comfortable with accepting it. So,
Glenn, did you have another question?
No, I just wanted to make sure that you know, if they fine us, the state, they fine us, not the person who put the chemicals or whatever into the sewage disposal plant, right? So,
yeah.
But what you're saying, we'd get reimbursed from the county for any.
We should be able to pass through any violations to them because
and that's
if they're discharging according to the agreement, we will never see the issues in our pass through or in our permit limits. So.
Okay.
Okay. Any other questions or discussion? If not, I'd entertain a motion on this agreement.
Make a motion to approve the agreement.
Motion by John.
Second.
Seconded by David. Discussion? If not, we'll move to a vote. Motion passes. Agenda item number 15. Agenda item number 15, consider the approval of the sponsorship agreement between the City of Marshall and Marshall Lumber Company doing business as East Hardware of Marshall regarding the Red Baron Arena and Expo Center. Dennis?
Thank you, Mayor and Council. The sponsorship agreement between the city and Ace Hardware is provided. 3-year agreement, $3,000 per year for sponsorship. It sets forth in the agreement the advertising parameters that Ace will receive. Ace has come forward to be a sponsor or partner in this arrangement. We believe it's that we should proceed to approve.
Okay, and the actual agreement itself, we're dealing with several of these this evening.
Yes.
They all follow the same process and the solicitation and
right. And this is not an exclusivity.
Right.
This is a sponsorship. They're paying a price, and they are receiving the advertising benefits. So there is a quid pro quo here. They receive something for that $3,000.
Okay. Thank you, Dennis. Are there questions? David?
Discussing this with staff earlier, it's my understanding, and I'll stand to be corrected if I have the wrong connection of things, that some of the signage that these three sponsorship agreements deal with are already in place. Is that, in fact, the case?
Some of the signage, yes. Some of the sponsorship is already in place. I believe ACE is not yet one of them.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. A portion of some of their signage is in place. Some of it completely not in place.
Okay. So it's partly yes, partly no.
Yes.
Yes, okay. Has that also been true, and I'll ask because I don't remember specifically, did we also have a situation with some of the other sponsorship agreements where signage was in place before the agreement was approved? Do we know?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
A lot of that was installed back in May.
Yeah. And so we were, okay, as long as that, for agreements that maybe weren't approved,
correct,
drafted or approved until several months
operating
later.
Operating on good faith, correct.
Yeah. And I understand the practicalities. You can't just whistle in a sign crew every 15 minutes and, you know, to do spot placement. But I do have a problem with this kind of approach, that we were, I'll just say up to potentially 3 months worth of courtesy signage display being provided for a potential vendor before the agreement has even come to the council. And I mean, I just have a problem with that operationally. A. B, how many more sponsorship agreements are still in the pipeline?
That may be a question for Dennis also.
Yeah.
At least four.
Okay, how many of those potential sponsors have signage already in place?
I don't believe any of those do.
No, one does, yeah. Bremer.
Correct.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, same comment. I think that's a, understand the practical limitations of installation and all that, but I still think there's a presumption there that doesn't reflect well on the facility or on the operations of the city, and accordingly I'll vote no on all three of these to make that point emphatic.
Do correct me if I have this information incorrectly, but some of these sponsors, I think it's ACE, D&G, Bremer, they came to the city wanting a sponsorship?
Correct.
Wasn't us soliciting.
I understand. I appreciate that point, but that's sort of at a 90-degree tangent. Thank you.
Okay, other questions?
With regard to this sponsorship agreement, while I'm looking at the one for ACE Hardware, it starts December, it says December 1st, 2016, so is it for the 12 months after that? And they have free advertising up until then, and another
it,
yeah, dream.
It is that? An added value that's built in. We didn't start the contract until December. Some of the other ones you'll see too don't start until January 1st.
And one here says the first payment is December 1st of 2017 is the first payment. That was for D&G.
Yep.
So their payment doesn't start till a year from now.
Are we addressing that one right now? Or?
Yeah, we'll address that one when it's
okay. Okay. The one of the things that I've noticed here is that in every package they give the sponsorship fee and then they also give the annual advertising package value. And it's kind of interesting. When we approved one for Lockwood Motors, they had a sponsorship fee of $15,000 per year, but evidently they're getting $49,400 worth of value. Action Manufacturing is paying $10,000 a year and they're getting $28,150 of advertising package per year. And ACE Hardware is paying $3,000 and is getting $5,000 worth of advertising package value. And D&G is getting, for their $3,000 sponsorship fee, they're getting $9,950 of advertising package value. With those numbers, it looks like we're subsidizing the advertising of all these businesses. They're paying less for the fee than what they're getting in value. I mean, there's a substantial difference in the value that they're getting and what they're paying.
Different as far as the opportunities, each time, there's only so many things you can advertise on in there. So to help build that value of what we wanted them to contribute, those dollar amounts were set up through Ignite, to certain things had certain values. So not everybody was able to have the exact same thing. You couldn't always compare apples to apples as far as what you were getting and what your, where your sign was going to be located. So different things have different values.
Right. And they do have values here, but like I said, you know, when the contract says $5,000 of value for a $3,000 fee, that it doesn't somehow add up.
We didn't have much to offer at the end.
Right, but I mean, that looks like a good deal for any company when they're getting $5,000 worth of advertising for $3,000 in cost. And so in a sense, we're subsidizing all of these businesses in their advertising efforts. At least that's the way it appears in writing.
I don't look at it that way. I look like we built a value for them to want to be a partner with us.
Any other questions?
So kind of a first come, first serve. The if you believe in it and buy in it first, you get to pick the better pieces. And if you're later to the prize table, the prizes are a little bit thinner. So it's kind of you snooze, you lose, or you know, some of them waited and some of them didn't want a better package than what they got. It just depends on what their needs and what they felt there was a gain to. And a lot of them, I believe, are stepping up because it's a civic commitment and the advertisement is the cherry that comes on top. A lot of them are doing it, I think, to support the community.
Any other points, David?
I think that's a fair comment and worthy if that's their motivation, but I think we also should be looking down the line a bit to think about how we best estimate the value of those packages for when the renewals come up. I mean, if the gap between the signed contract amount and the sort of estimated value is that big, well, you know, we'd like to get our fair share of that gap in the future. So let's be thinking about a process for that.
And some of that will be, you know, the rules of supply and demand. Yeah. You know, if we have 10 people coming to us again that want to sponsor on the Zamboni, then we know that we were probably a little light on that. And then to speak to your already declaring your no vote, I just want to mention that the previous city administrator was aware of those signs going up, and he gave us the blessing on that for those to be put up. So
that's fine, but that doesn't change the principle here.
Sure.
Any other questions? If not, well, just one other comment. I think the you know, through this whole process with there's really a limited number of spaces available. I think that was deliberate in planning to make the facility, you know, look clean and not cluttered. And so that's why there is a limited number of advertising spaces available for the sponsorship. And we certainly do appreciate those sponsors that have stepped up. With that, I'd entertain a motion on the recommendation.
Approval of the recommendation on the sponsorship agreement between the City of Marshall and Marshall Lumber, doing business as Ace Hardware of Marshall.
Motion by Craig, is there a second?
I second.
Seconded by Elaine. Discussion?
Kind of one comment going back on a little bit of what we've been talking about. I mean, we're kind of going whatever the market will bear, you might say, at one point. At this point, we're new, we're getting started. There is a little bit of faith advertising, it will come coming into this. So kind of to David's point, as we progress on and there's more activity, more things, there's potential for a better market out there as well too. So
in addition to faith, I might add the word fluff. There might be a little fluff. It is an unknown commodity or value as to what that advertising is worth. We're taking some other facilities, you know, what they have valued at. And you're right, over a period of time, yes, what is that faith worth?
Fluff, that's a legal term?
Yes, it is.
Marketing term.
Hey, any other discussion on the motion? If not, we'll move to a vote. Motion passes. We'll note the one abstention. Agenda item number 16. Agenda item number 16 is, this is a sponsorship between the City of Marshall and Viking Coca-Cola regarding the Red Baron Arena and Expo. Dennis, are you going to start with this, or Darren, since you're standing up here? Of course, we have already dealt with the the first part of this agreement, and then this is the formal sponsorship.
Yes, the council has already approved the concept of Viking Coca-Cola being the exclusive soft drink beverage provider. What has been the difficulty is negotiating how those terms play out over a 10-year period of time, and the biggest one involved, if the city should, you know, cancel the agreement mid-term, how does, you know, Viking Coca-Cola wanted the prorated portion of their initial donation refunded, which basically would have been, and it's $18,000 a year for 10 years, $180,000, and they were prepared to put that money up front right away. But we would have basically had to escrow that money, not have any use of that money, except for a yearly basis once a year passes. And they, you know, we didn't cancel the contract, we could have use of that money. So we finally negotiated, let's just make it an annual payment instead of us having the money up front. That's, I think, an act of good faith from both the city and Viking that we will continue to work together. If the city terminates, then the unused portion of that money for that 1 year period of time would be refunded. So we're only at risk for $18,000. And then it did take a time to work out some of the details, but that was the biggest holdup. It has been signed. We do have the signed agreement back from Viking Coca-Cola. So they have been involved in this process and have had the signage in place pursuant to action that the council took several months ago. So recommend approval.
Okay. Questions on this sponsorship agreement? John?
But then it's in effect then, there really is no escrow? It's it's an $18,000 annual payment?
Payment, yes.
Okay.
Yes. Other questions? If not, I would entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion to approve the sponsorship between City of Marshall and Viking Coca-Cola.
Second.
Motion by John, seconded by Larry. Discussion? If not, we'll move to a vote. Motion passes. Agenda item number 17. Agenda item number 17, this is a consideration of the sponsorship agreement between the City of Marshall and D&G Excavating regarding the Red Baron Arena and Expo. Once again, Dennis, we'll start with you, and Darren, you can add any color to that.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. Basically, it's, you know, D&G Excavating approached City of Marshall regarding the sponsorship agreement, 5-year commitment, $3,000 a year. The first year, there is no financial payment. It is a donation of artwork, donation of, you know, sports memorabilia, something of the value for them of about $3,000. So combination of art plus money equals $15,000 over a 5-year period of time.
Questions on this?
What, just for peace of mind, what's the artwork?
You were there today. You missed it.
I dashed in because I went to the wrong place, remember?
Yeah. In the club room, the Gruha family has given us some artwork, sports artwork. One is a limited Fogarty print of Minnesota Wild and the XL Energy Center. The other two that they've given us at this point, and there is actually a fourth one that will be coming in also. The other two are Miracle on Ice signed prints from the entire team from the 1980 Miracle on Ice team. They will definitely be a great value for the club room, added attractions, much like the donated or the items that we have on display from the United States Hockey Hall of Fame also. So just a great addition to the club room, and
thank you.
Great for them to give us those.
A follow-up to that. If we got something that special, signed originals of the Olympics gold medal winning team, what kind of security and protection arrangements are we going to have for it?
We've offered what we can. The club room is locked. Unless you have a key, you can't get in there.
What about protection against slops and spills? And
they're far enough off the ground. I would treat them as if they were my own. I would feel very safe if they were my own from where they're at from a strategic standpoint. They're not. You can't bump them unless you were to move something above 5 feet tall.
We're not too worried about incidental contact.
Yeah.
Then. All right. Thank you.
Great.
Other questions?
I'll move the approval of sponsorship between the City of Marshall and D&G.
Second.
Motion by Larry, seconded by Craig. Discussion? If not, we'll move to a vote. Motion passes. Agenda item number 18. Agenda item number 18, consider the renaming of 240th Avenue to Pacific Avenue in Commerce Industrial Park. The action before us would be to consider the adoption of the ordinance. Glenn?
Thank you, Mayor and Council. That's exactly what it is. It's just a change of name of an existing township road to a city street name, and then it will be included in the final plat of Commerce Industrial Park. We've established names for the various roads within the park, and we would recommend approval of the change of road name.
Any questions on this? If not, is there a motion?
I think. Okay. Second.
So did Craig make that motion?
Yes, sir.
Motion by Craig, seconded by Larry. Discussion? No discussion, we'll move to a vote. Motion passes. Agenda item number 19. Agenda item number 19, consider authorization of the concession sponsorship. Dennis, once again, you'll start with you, and Darren, you should come up.
I believe this one would best start with Darren.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead. Or sure. Nick, did you want to introduce this?
I certainly can. This is concerning an RFP that was put out for sponsorship of the concession areas inside of the arena. We received one back from Reinhardt, but both Reinhardt and Maxwell both responded to the RFP.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. We met with representatives from Maxwell. We met with representatives from Reinhardt at the same time at the concession, the kitchen area, in the Red Baron Arena. We asked them for their best proposal for how to best utilize the kitchen area and to bring those back to us. We did get two proposals. They both came out to be within about 10% of each other. One had tax figured into it, and I'd have to rely on the council and the city attorney. I'm not sure if the city pays tax on that kind of equipment.
You have to look at that.
Yeah, if it doesn't, it brings the bids even closer, within $200 of each other. So we also, met with them, we discussed that we did have one sponsorship opportunity available yet. That was the naming of our main rink. We hadn't utilized that yet. So we asked for proposals back from both companies, and we did get proposals back from two companies. I did meet with Maxwell, Larry, right?
Yes.
Larry's here too. There was some discussion whether he wanted his proposal to be a part of this or whether he didn't, and I think ultimately we need to recognize that Maxwell was a very important part of this, and that tension of having Maxwell and Reinhardt both in the same room really paid off dividends for us.
Okay, questions for Darren?
Darren, I have one question. The use of the equipment, is there any conditions on that? As far as outside usages?
You know, I would say that between whoever our concession operator ends up being, they will have obviously use of it. I wouldn't be surprised if in the final details of the contract that Maxwell may want to use the equipment for demonstration.
Reinhardt
may want to use the equipment for demonstration at some point. And that's something that we could work out in the details.
We're not going to make that concession area available to people that are just renting the facility, though.
Correct.
For use for having their burger feed or
correct.
Something like that. Okay.
David? Narrow question here about the technical specs. It's an item the countertop griddle, and then I guess the item at the top of page 2, it says gas type to be specified. What can you tell me about that?
You know, I can't speak to that. I'm not the equipment expert. I will say this, the equipment list that we gave both Maxwell and Reinhardt were recommendations from the Schwann Food Company and our consultant that that the city hired back last year to give us what they thought would be the best specs for equipment.
And that's fine. I'm just curious. I mean, Craig, you know, think something about things that blow up. What are our options here?
Only if I'm using them.
Propane, I assume, is one
yeah,
option.
Yeah, I think the spec is dictating whether you intend to hook it to liquid propane gas or natural gas.
Okay, depending on the configuration.
Exactly.
And, okay.
And of course, we would request natural gas. Just saying.
Natural gas sounds good to me, Craig. Thank you.
Okay, any other questions?
I was going to say, as part of the discussion ongoing between my office, the engineer's office, on change orders within the facility, a number of change orders have resulted from an enhancement of the concession, the food area anyway. And this just finishes that area off. I think it goes hand in hand with the decisions previously made to enhance and make the experience there better by having a top quality concessions area. And then by the addition of this equipment, we'll certainly make that a nice, nice facility.
Larry from Maxwell.
Yes, I'm Larry from Maxwell's. I, you know, withdrew my bid at one time last week because I knew I was a small player in a big pond, you know, and then when I saw our proposals on the internet, you know, of the equipment and how close they were, I came back into it because as I looked at Schwann's recommendations for equipment, you know, which was very positive to look at. Our two bids are, if you look at the equipment, I believe as a citizen for this place, that needs to work. I think we need a drawing and need to sit down with not me or the other competitor and let Schwann look at, I lay out kitchens. We need a cook to not walk very many steps. He needs to turn here, turn here. And I look at my competitors and I'm going, there's no room in this place for what is proposed. I mean, I came back into this only for one reason, not to see if I could get the bid, but, you know, because I can't compete with, I see what they're asking for, you know, but I think it needs to be drawn and let an outside person design this the way it needs to be designed. Because I was proud of my design, but I'm not going to say it's the right one. I'd like to have a chef look at this and say, if you were working in this kitchen, where are you going to cut a pizza? Where are you going to put a burger? Where are you going to put your French fries when you're, you know, I look at my competitors and it's not there, you know. And that's the only reason I came. It's the only reason I put my bid back in.
Okay. Thank you. We appreciate your input.
And I will say this, you know, the city did hire a consultant who did draw out the kitchen, and the city paid money for that consultant, and that's what we based that off of, so.
Have you seen that drawing?
Yeah, I have that drawing, but no small equipment is in it. None of the stuff that's in ours is in it besides the two Coke coolers, you know, that was already in the kitchen. You know, we didn't have fryers in it and need to put it under the hood.
Right.
You know, we have a pizza oven that needs to be under the hood. We have no room for, the hood is not very big. You know, I had a tough time making it work. And, you know, like I said, I'm not saying mine is the one, but I would like to see a Schwann person or the guy that gave this recommendation just draw both plans and say, how is this going to work? You know, I mean, I hear it every day I do a restaurant design is I want flow, I want flow, I want flow. We're putting a kitchen in a closet. This is a small place. And being on second floor, then we have to have refrigeration not very far away. You know, all those pizzas that are going to come in frozen. You know, it's a big deal. I think it needs to be looked at.
Thank you. David?
Is it possible to accept that what's before us here and still have that additional degree of review by somebody else?
I would say yes, just from the fact that this isn't something new for Reinhardt. I mean, this is what they do. It's their...
I understand,
and we can work with them to
okay.
For what your point is
okay.
To make sure that they had the same drawing that Larry did. So
I mean, we've heard one point of view on this. You know, if Reinhart were here, they might, I have no idea what they'd say, but I think on its face, those concerns need some attention, and we need some understanding here that either Reinhart or somebody else will take a fresh look at it and make adjustments as necessary.
And we certainly want it functional when everything's installed.
Yeah, Mr. Mayor, thank you. And to add on to what Councilman Sturrock is saying, and this is a conversation that I've had on and off with a couple of different people involved with the arena and expo, and concerns that I heard early in the discussion about soliciting proposals from potential concessioners, and the fact that I don't know exactly where the changes came in, but I believe that concession area shrunk by about 35% in the process of construction and coming to completion. And I know there's concerns that we don't have a lot of mechanical storage area, you know, the coolers, freezers, and that we're giving up some mechanical space, but not real close to the piece. And I agree that I think I want to see people that are in the business that do it every day, so I would consider them not just good at it, but experts. And if we're going to be looking at change orders and doing this, I think we have one chance to really do this thing right. And I don't want to see us finish a couple things that we did that maybe we shouldn't by doing a few more things that we shouldn't. And I would really like to make sure that we look at this, and if there's some things we need to change around to get it absolutely right to work so that it's going to work for 20 or 30 years, I think we need to do that.
Mayor, if that's the case, and I agree with the point you're making, does that mean that we decline the agreement pending further discovery?
You can table action.
Yeah,
table.
Table would be the appropriate action.
All right. Then I'll make the motion to table the agreement till the earliest possible opportunity to get some further address to these issues.
I'll second that motion.
Motion to table by David, seconded by Craig. Nick, you had a...
Just to make sure we understand, we're not approving any agreement tonight. We're just approving the drafting of an agreement tonight, if that affects the decision to table.
And I just would like to mention one thing. If it can be worded that we work with Reinhart and somebody to finish this off the right way, we are under very time-sensitive material.
Recognizing that, if it's agreeable to the seconder, I'll withdraw my motion and change it to, we'll authorize the further work, tell me if this is right, Dennis, on the concession agreement with the specific attention to these space and layout concerns addressed.
Okay, just for parliamentary procedure, you're first withdrawing your motion. Did you withdraw your second?
I did.
Okay, you're making a new motion.
Yes.
And I'm seconding the new motion.
Right. Payne, did you get that all down?
No, I have none of it down.
Why not?
Okay.
Don't worry about the first one.
all right. Well, Darren picks a good time to leave.
Are we voting on these two first motions and seconds?
No. There's no motion on the floor now because...
Okay.
His motion. So now he's going to make a new motion.
And the motion would be?
She does have to wait in the minutes.
To proceed with Jane, the item that's on our table here, to consider authorization of concession sponsorship with, that's how it's listed here under new business. To authorize city staff and city attorney to engage in drafting a sponsorship agreement with Reinhart Food Services, contingent upon city attorney's review, just as we have it under recommendation number one. That'll be my motion, with the additional language that the space...
So you're doing the original motion with additional language?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, let me get back to the
original. We thought the kitchen was complicated. With the understanding that space and layout concerns be given
review and guidance, or review and input,
are carefully reviewed for possible adjustments.
Should we look to see if we can bring our consultant back down who did the original drawing and have him work with
I think that would be up to staff to either work with the, the consultant or other expertise that might be available.
I think I have it.
I'll check with you afterward.
Okay, so
well,
that.
I'm going to submit this and you're all going to see it.
Okay, well, that's supporting.
So we have a motion by David. Do we have a second?
Yes, I'll second it.
Seconded by Craig. Now discussion on the motion. We see the restated motion on our screens.
Yeah.
That's good.
That's fine by me.
Yep. Larry?
Thank you.
The only concern I have that doing it this way, it depends upon how much time this is going to take. We have to understand that November 8th, am I correct? Early
we
November.
We could use it on the 5th.
We have some hockey games going on there. And, you know, somewhere or another, we have to have a concession stand that's got to be ready and up and ready to go.
Okay,
and I think the,
and
the
that's
language
the intent
in your
here.
Motion is consistent with that. We just want to be sure that it's functional.
We need to get it right. I mean, I don't want to see us stand it, but we cannot be dragging this on for two or three more meetings. It's, you know.
Oh, that'd be fun.
Is the city going to be?
How much did you spend, Aaron, on that recommendation?
What's that?
How much did you spend with the consultant on that recommendation?
The city spent $9,000.
And Schwann reviewed that entire thing, so are you prepared?
It was from the recommendation the guy we got came from Schwann.
If you make the concession stand bigger, are you prepared to do that?
Mm-hmm.
That's going to be the recommendation. The size of the concession stand was completely consulted already and came up with what they saw, which Schwann's agreed to.
With what's in there right now?
Yes.
There's no equipment in there right now.
It was all designed with equipment that was put out in specs.
We didn't see it. I didn't see it.
So okay. If you're spending more money, you're going to get the same concession stand as X size today.
I guess my concern, David, tell me if this is your concern. I'm not a cooking chef expert. I play one at home, but I'm not really one. I want to make sure that what we have and what's in there is what's fitting and right. And if that's the case, if the confirmation is yes, that's good, then I'm good. But if it's not, what do we need to do to fix it? Can we fix it? You know, do we take something out? Do we change something to make it right? Maybe we don't have as big of a deep fryer as what's in the spec. I don't know what that answer is. That's what I want those people to find out.
So the just to restate what the language in the motion is, it's moving forward on the original proposed schedule. It's directing the city attorney to draft the sponsorship agreement, and then the added language is, let's be sure we have the right configuration of
the equipment
that's going to be installed.
Yep.
Okay.
We're all clear, right?
Any other discussion on the motion?
We're going to do this all in a timely fashion so that we can serve pizza at our first time.
We'll see you at the next meeting.
In the next meeting, next regular meeting, that will be the 27th. We actually do have a budget workshop meeting on the 19th. At that meeting. Other discussion on the motion? If not, we'll move to a vote.
Craig.
That motion does pass. Jane, for the minutes, we will, even though it was not voted on, we will note in the minutes that there was a motion made and seconded and withdrawn.
And I'll go back and rewatch the video.
Okay, very good. Then we'll move to agenda item number 20. Agenda item number 20, Southwest Minnesota Regional Amateur Ball Park Concessions Building. We have several change orders to consider. Glenn?
Thank you, Mayor and Council. I'm going to tag team this with Preston, if he could come up to the podium with me. Generally, these change orders involve installation of materials not considered in the original concessions building. And I think we'll go through them one at a time. So if you could bring up change order number one. And if you go down to the, yep, there you go. So you can see that there's some credits for certain things that were included, but mostly it's installation of, in this one, the electrical items that were not part of the concessions building. It was electrical items for coordination with the field lighting. That is the electrical tie-in. So we had several conduits that needed to come into the mechanical room of the concessions building for control. We also had the communications vault. It's the same type of addition that was not included originally in the concessions building. The fixtures and lavatory sinks were deleted from the kitchen area, I'll call it. We decided that we were not going to be putting in a concessions area similar to the Red Baron Arena. The reason for that is just the hood was $100,000. So we were in discussions with the health department for what we should install there and not install. The hose bibs, that was, we wanted just water spigots on the outside of the building. And the RPZs are for, it's a valve to not allow water to come back into the line from the pitcher's mounds. We've got water going out to the dugouts, but we didn't want water to be coming back from the pitcher's mounds when we water that down and might lay a hose down. So these are things that are required by the health department for installation. The sink in the concessions building is one of those required three sink units, stainless steel. We thought that we may not have to have that, but they said that no, you have to have a triple sink stainless steel facility if you're serving food in the concessions building, because you might have some utensils or something like that you may have to clean, and it has to be that sink. So that's the first one.
And we will take questions. These one at a time. So,
yeah. Yeah.
So questions on change order number one?
Anything else that Preston and I need to touch base on? Maybe a little more explanation of the communications vault. That's right outside the building.
Yeah, the communications will be for any, I think VAST has a communication line up there, as well as if and when we add a sound system to either the concession building itself or to the backstops or similar areas. The conduits are all in, so that we didn't get in a bind where, okay, well, we want to add sound, but now we have to tear up all the concrete around the concession stand to get it out of the building. And they ran to the backstops. Like I said, the conduits are in place, so if we ever decide we want to add that, we're covered. The lighting controls, you guys may remember last year we bid that and awarded that to have the install done. However, all the electrical work's not included in the concession building bid because it wasn't part of ATS&R's project. So we needed to get, we have there again, all the conduits are in to about 20 feet away from the concession stand, and the control panel will be in the concession stand, which we couldn't put in last year because we didn't have a concession stand to put the control panel into. So it's just kind of tying all the loose ends together here now, and why they had it all exposed. It was easy for the electrical contractor to run the conduits into the building.
Any questions on change order number one? Is there a motion to allow change order number one?
So moved.
Motion by Larry. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by John. Discussion?
It's just comment and partially what you said, Preston, and we have in here is that The reason for the change order is because we didn't know at the time of the original design where things were, what we were going to do. So it was really intentional that there would be a change order at some point.
Utilities pulled all the conduit into a manhole or a hand box, I think they call it. So everything's just sitting there. And without tying that in, it would have still just sat there with no connection. So it was just a matter of getting the placement lined up with once they had poured the footings for the wall so we could get precise placement.
Any other discussion on the motion? If not, we'll move to a vote on the approval of change order number one. The motion passes. Now change order number two, also with Moe's contracting. Glenn, I'll turn to you first.
Yes. Behind the dugouts, there was a drainage mat that was bid, and you can see we deducted the drainage mat from the contract because we have a granular backfill behind the dugouts already with a drain tile located at the bottom. And we didn't believe that a drainage mat would be necessary. Instead, we just had a waterproofing membrane placed on the back of the dugouts. The concession equipment power, that was the additional electrical work necessary to get a conduit and a plug-in to the front of the concessions building area that a concessions trailer can plug into. That's that one. And the Musco lighting control cabinet, that was for the additional lighting and the cabinet itself that needed to be placed inside the concessions building that really was not a part of the concessions building. It's part of the lighting system. And just what Preston indicated earlier, there was no place to put that prior to the concessions building being constructed. That's why it wasn't in Musco's original bid package. Okay. Anything extra, Preston? I think that was it.
Questions the council may have for either Glenn or Preston? If not, I'd entertain a motion.
Make a motion to approve change order number two.
Second.
Motion by John, seconded by David. Discussion?
I have one comment, just FYI, won't affect this, but also included when we did those electrical conduits, if we ever add lights to what I call fields 3 and 4 or the southern lights, all those conduits are run into the building, as well as a spot for that panel that we'd have to buy from Musco, so we're covered for the future in that.
Any other discussion? If not, we'll move to a vote. Motion passes. And then change order number three. Glenn?
I have to open mine. Okay. This was for the concessions building itself has gutters and downspouts that lead to the ground. And we have a storm sewer system, I think it was about 30 feet away, where we're in the layout, the downspouts that come down would attach to a 6-inch PVC tile and then connect to two of the downspouts. There's two on one side of the building, two on the other side of the building. Each of those downspouts would be connected to a leader, it's called, that would go to the existing storm sewer that's there. The existing storm sewer then has to have that leader come to it and a hole drilled into the side of the manhole, storm sewer manhole, for that water to get to the storm sewer. That was not included in the design of the concessions building, so it was added that leader, the downspouts are there, but the leader wasn't. So that's what it says, cost to add downspouts to existing storm sewer. It's really not the downspouts. It's the leader from the downspouts to the storm sewer. And then the additional landscape block seating, if you look at the layout of the seating area, when they started building it, you could see that there was kind of a tall wall that you could maybe push your butt up to on top of and sit. But instead of building it that way, it was much easier to make it a standard size seat and add additional seating by shortening that tall back set of seats and have a whole nother set of seats by adding about $500 per area. And looking at it on site, it was kind of obvious to do. The plans looked fine, but when you got out there and took a look at it, it was, gosh, to add a whole nother row of seating by adding $500 per field, it was kind of a gimme. So we would recommend, Preston, go ahead.
I think changing that wall and adding a second row, I think it was like 112 linear feet of seating that we added for that $500 for each field. I mean, 112 times four, so we had about 500 linear feet. We went from one row of seating on each side of the field would be different, but we only had one usable seat, and now we have three the whole length of that till the dugout.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions on that? A recommendation? If not, I'd entertain a motion.
So moved.
Motion by Craig. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Larry. Discussion? If not, we'll move to a vote. Motion passes. Just one quick question, and then you may have something to add. Did I understand you correctly that we'll still need to add the sound speaker system?
Yep. If it's not really something that we've talked a whole lot about, but it's just kind of one of those things that just in case we do want to, I know it'll be hard with four fields being there, but maybe we just put speakers, you know, on the corners of the building or under the overhang or something like that. But that could be a future.
One more thing with Preston still up here. I do want to have a short conversation with you about the concessions trailer. I put that in the memo on purpose, understanding that the concessions trailer is going to be very important. We took all of the expense out of the, I'll say, the kitchen of the concessions building because of the additional cost and the requirements of the health department. By doing the concessions trailer parked outside on the concrete, outside the overhang, and bringing the food in, will allow us not only to have that unit available for the softball games, but other events in the park system, like Independence Park, when we want to do something,
Fourth of July, or
going out to the other ball fields, to Legion Field ball field, you could actually have it trailered out there. Just wanted to mention that because we had a significant reduction in the cost of the kitchen area due to taking all of the equipment out of it. It's not part of this discussion, but I want you to be aware of that for concessions.
And then you want to spend just a minute talking about the construction progress? And
sure do. You know, we'd like to see it going along faster, but I think in about 24 days, we had 17 days of rain, and that is kind of slowing us up on all of our projects, not just that one. But the Mohs Contracting has committed themselves to get this project done as quickly as possible. The owner is there every week on Mondays to meet with us and give us an update of schedule. We'll have a revised written schedule by the contractor next week coming to the meeting. But they brought in an additional concrete company. One's doing flat work, the other's doing block work, to kind of catch up to where they should be. Now, I will admit that in doing that, it was kind of like a bunch of ants in an ant pile for a while. And they did some damages to some of the system that's there, like the irrigation system needed to be repaired because of damage. They did have a piece of equipment run into one of the backstops, which we'll have to take care of with the fencing and the pole itself, maybe some repainting. So in doing that, and if you go out there right now, you see the slab with all the plumbing sticking up out of the ground. You know, normally they'll do that with the block layers and bring it up a piece at a time. But to get it done, they came in and put all the standpipes up and venting and did it really as quick as they could get it done. Now they have a different block layer that came in. We had some issues with the block layer they had out at the Merit Center. They hired a different crew at a more expensive rate to come in and do this. They also they wanted to do all of their waterproofing on the backs of the dugouts with one mobilization from that subcontractor. Well, in order to expedite the process, they had to bring him in with more mobilizations to come in, and he covered that. It wasn't an extra for the city to come in and do that. So he had more mobilizations because of bringing in the additional concrete people to do the work when they were available. So the schedule is, I'll tell you, probably a little bit behind schedule, but I will say the contractor is doing a real good job at trying to get back on track. Comments?
I think next week sounds like, from the road, you'll be able to visibly tell all the steel showed up today for the building, and the blocks come in Tuesday. It's ready for block to be laid. So once that starts going, I think you'll see progress instead of flat work.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you for that explanation. At this point, I'll call for a 5-minute recess.
Thank you, Mayor and Council.
I was going to thank Nick for keeping me on track with exactly like Ben did it. Ben would tell me I'm first on, and I'd get here and I'm like 28th. And then to make it worse, right before
why
I'm
change
on, the mayor always
works.
Calls a break. So thanks for making me feel at home. This is, I'll give you a little backdrop. We've gone through, as you're probably aware, maybe have heard or read, we've had a couple different hotel opportunities that, for one reason or the other, whether it be private reasons or just something that happened, we've had a couple different hotels that we thought were going to come to Marshall and ended up not. Throw in addition to that, there's always this, the talk from the existing hotels that we have enough rooms, or we don't have enough rooms, or we need this, or we don't need this. So we have had in the back of our mind over the last month or so to call for what's called a feasibility study. You've approved some things like that in the past where we did a housing study, very similar thing except it deals with the hotel side of things. It might be actually a little bit more extensive than a housing study. Last housing study we did was going to be about 23,000. We negotiated down to a little less than 20 because they had done one 6, 7, 8 years ago for us. But this would be a similar approach, but would be to really give us a real good honest look, not an internal look, not a hotel's look, not my look, but a real honest look at what is the potential for more hotel rooms, newer hotel rooms, what size hotel rooms, how many rooms, all of those kinds of things would be developed in the feasibility study. They take into consideration future events, so they would meet with people from the Red Baron Arena, from all the different organizations in town. Are we going to have more events coming up? Are we going to have less events, the same number of events? So very, very extensive. So with that being said, about the time we were thinking about actually asking to do a feasibility study, I had a company called Gatehouse Capital contact me. Very, very popular in the United States, does a lot of work in Texas. They actually got Marshall, Minnesota's name at a big EDA conference. Somebody told them you need to talk to Cal Brink in Marshall, Minnesota, because what they're doing there would really fit what they do for a living. And what they do for a living is they approach a city and talk about the potential, and I'm not going to get into a lot of detail because you're going to be involved from square one if we end up pursuing this, but they basically take a hotel concept with a civic center concept, build the entire thing, use of some city funds to do that, reimburse the city back at the end, and the city ends up with a civic center that they didn't pay for. One of those totally too good to be true things, I understand that. Nick and I have probably been in three or four meetings with that group. I've probably been in seven or eight meetings. Dennis is involved. I got Michaela and Springstead involved probably three or four meetings into it. So where we've got to for tonight's purpose, they actually, part of their normal procedure would be to ask the city to put $150,000 up for what they call their pre-development plan. Part of that pre-development plan would be a feasibility study. In our last internal meeting with Nick kind of directing that, we actually made the decision to go back to Gatehouse Capital and tell them we weren't comfortable putting $150,000 up. We are comfortable paying the first $20,000 for the feasibility study, which would have been the first piece of theirs, but why start a pre-development plan, what the hotel is going to look like, the architectural design, if the feasibility study doesn't come back and support that. So if, in fact, we go with the feasibility study, everything looks good, we would then go into the pre-development where we would be back to ask you to consider investing in that pre-development, which it talks about in here. If the project goes to fruition and happens, we get all of that $150,000 reimbursed. So it's basically saying they are popular enough and do good enough work where they ask communities to invest before they stick a lot of money in the project and then have a community pull out. So we've decided to take what maybe call it baby steps where we've asked them to allow us to invest $20,000 and do it in steps. If the feasibility study comes back, quite honestly, the likelihood of the project coming to fruition becomes very likely. We've got some hurdles we got to get through. One of them being we would like it constructed on the city property that is actually right on the Red Baron Arena property. They claim they've done some preliminary work outside of the pre-development agreement that they can do that. So we would likely end up with something like a civic center that's hooked to the Red Baron Arena. You'd see it in the cities and some metro areas where you'd walk into the hotel, you check in on the main level, convention space on the main level, and you go up the elevator to your rooms. That would be, they can fit it onto a small space. And I can't name names, but we're talking some really, really big time hotel chain names. Something that would most people would not believe would have the opportunity to have in Marshall. So bottom line is this, we're requesting that the city spend $20,000 from the EDA fund, which is what those funds are meant to be spent on. If that $20,000 feasibility study comes back positive, as soon as the feasibility study comes back, we will enter into work session. I think we talked about a month from now, maybe it's 5 weeks. And then we would really lay out the details of, let you actually take part in, here's what the feasibility study says. So I don't want to come back here and say the feasibility study looks good, let's put some more money into it. I want everybody to be involved in that feasibility. If they say, and they're going to tell us, we know how many rooms you have, we know how many rooms are 40 years old, we know how many rooms are 30 years old, we know how many rooms are 20 years old, and then the hotel chain would then look at, we're talking a hotel with 100, 120 rooms here, not a 40 or 50 room hotel. So, and then Dennis actually advised that in addition to their pre-development plan, I'll kind of just walk through that. Once we get past, I don't want to talk a lot beyond the feasibility study because that's what tonight is really about. Once we get beyond that though, then it comes into hotel drawings, conceptual drawings, how does it fit on the property, how does it hook to the building. We get all the architects that were involved in the Red Baron Arena back involved. But what we really felt needed to be done was a memorandum of understanding. Dennis drafted, I don't know if you can pull that up, Nick. That actually just protects us. It says that we don't have to put any money other than the $20,000. Even if the feasibility study comes back, looks like we could probably do it, we're still interested in doing it, we would have the right to back out and own the feasibility study. Because it's important, if we think that this is too big of a project for us and we want to go after a 60-room hotel, Gatehouse would then back out, we'd own the feasibility study, and we could use that to market for another hotel chain, which, quite honestly, isn't out of the question. I mean, that could be one of, so Dennis felt it was important, and I totally agree that we would want to make sure that they would sign the language that says for any, and the city should have the right for whatever reason to cancel the pre-development plan at any time after conclusion of the feasibility study. They estimate the feasibility study probably be 3 to 4 weeks. I was going to say,
in addition to that, paragraph number one on this memorandum of understanding while the feasibility study is in place, at the same time, we're doing a little better due diligence financial inquiry into who is this group Gatehouse Capital. You know, we want to make sure that they are who they say they are, that they have the financial wherewithal to complete the project should we proceed. So there's kind of two tracks going on, a feasibility study, but also a financial due diligence of the company that potentially we may be using to assist in this project. So,
and those are things from Dun & Bradstreet checks to financial, open and financial records. They've given us a list of potential references where they've actually completed projects, as well as some references where they didn't continue with the project. I think it's just as important to talk to somebody where they didn't get the project for whatever reasons and see how they handle those cases. But for tonight's purposes, the request is for you to authorize $20,000 we spent from the EDA fund for the feasibility study only.
Thank you, Cal. Questions?
Is it your feelings or your opinion that there's not enough, we don't have enough motels and hotels in town?
Well, it's my opinion. I'd like somebody else to say it other than me. Because when I say it, it doesn't hold the water that would feasibility study. My actual feelings are, we've got about 350 to 400 rooms. Where we run into issues is when teams are trying to book rooms and they won't stay in rooms that don't have pools, and I won't name names, or rooms that are tired. And by tired, the industry says if your rooms are 30 years old, they're tired. And that's what we run into, Glenn, where we'll actually have a tournament here that has enough teams to fill the rooms, but our rooms aren't filled because they're in Granite Falls or Morton. And I'm a supporter of all the hotels we have, and actually as part of this feasibility study, if it would happen to come back that we're short a certain amount of rooms, I would welcome to work with any of the existing hotels to add space, add rooms, remodel rooms, and that would be part of the feasibility study. It would make more sense for the community to invest in their current hotels or build a 60-room hotel, 80-room hotel, 100-room hotel. And I'm going into it, honestly, totally open-minded. I mean, if I can help an existing business and give them a plausible reason to invest in their current location, I'd be thrilled with that, too.
Aren't there plans to build a new motel by the mall?
That's gone from going to happen to not going to happen to maybe going to happen to maybe not going to happen to last week. Thinks he has the lot sold. I don't think he has the lot sold. And he's gone, you know, that is a, it's a tip. He's talked about doing less of a project. I know we're getting a little off track here, but he still wants to do some remodeling of the mall and some refacial of the mall, but there is no TIF without a hotel or apartments. I mean, it was only gonna be done with increments, so I've told him, just, I guess FYI to you, I've told him that at this point, I see it as a private project that does not need any city help. If you're going to invest in your own property because of private reasons and there is no TIF involved, then it's private development. We're out of the deal. So that's kind of where that's at.
My concern is I want to be fair to the existing motel owners. And sometimes we bring in the competition and the existing businesses can't make it. They go out of business. And it just doesn't seem fair to help new businesses start up in Marshall and we drive out existing businesses.
And that's why I made the comment. I mean, the feasibility study I would envision would be made available to all the current hoteliers to actually, if the feasibility study, and it's not done by us, shows that this is what you're lacking and one of them wants to step forward. What we ended up here, Glenn, is we have an opportunity to have something done way outside the normal and potentially end up with a $6-7 million convention center that we don't pay for. And we got to explore it. For $20,000, we got to explore it and see if it's possible.
When we started this Red Baron Arena project, there was always the thought that there'd be a hotel convention center, some type of thing attached to that. We've gone through several proposals or people that have come forward, and for whatever reason, that's never flown. By hiring an outside source, we'll get that input on what their opinion is. It won't just be us saying this is what we're going to do and not what we're going to do. And I think, you know, this is something that we got to do, and they will tell us if we need more rooms or less rooms in the city of Marshall according to what our potential is, and they'll get a feel from that thing, the people they talk to. So I think even the hotels that are existing
would be excited about this because this will tell them what is going to or not going to come in the future. Mm-hmm. I think it's a no-brainer that we have got to do this. With that, I'd make the recommendation to approve it.
Okay. Motion by Larry, seconded by David. Discussion.
Wasn't there plans to build a motel just west of the high school there? I mean, that property was purchased and...
That's Shilas's, that property. Shilas's property was the one right next to the Red Baron Arena that kind of goes out toward Highway 23.
That's what he's talking about.
He okay. is now paid $270,000 for that lot. He's now asking $1.1 million for it. And basically said, if I can sell it for $1.1 million, why would I build a hotel? So we can't get somebody to buy that lot. We've tried. There was another actually, the hotel that was going to build in the mall decided they wanted to build out by the Red Baron Arena. Swans actually ended up not being able to close that deal on the lot. They wanted to sell all 22 acres. They wouldn't sell one piece. So that one went away. So it just kind of lends itself back to let's find out what we really need and then go after the right kind of hotel. I totally agree with everything you said. I mean, it's frustrating, though. We've had really three hotels now that have, we're going to do it. Shilas, I think, he was the one that was supposed to be building the same time the Red Baron Arena was built. Supposed the grand opening was going to be the same time. Got cold feet for whatever reason, started another project in Iowa, a bigger project. Just somehow got cold feet, and I think he saw an opportunity in his mind to make a lot of money without building a hotel.
Other discussion on the motion?
One last question. That Gatehouse Capital, they're a big time operation. I mean, they're nationwide and probably international. You don't feel like they're too big time for us in Marshall?
That was my, actually, that was my original thought. And it goes, again, the feasibility study will actually tell me if they are. I mean, he actually quoted that they're not doing a feasibility study to convince Marshall to use them. They're doing a feasibility study to convince us both. And I seriously think it isn't impossible that the feasibility would come back saying, you know what, it'd be great to have a Marriott here, but quite honestly, it's probably too small of a market. That's a possibility. They don't want to start a project that's not going to fund itself either.
Other discussion on the motion? Now we'll move to a vote.
Thanks.
Motion passes. Agenda item number 22. Agenda item number 22, consider the approval of 2017 fee resolution. With us tonight is our finance director, Carla Drown.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. Before you have draft one, which went to the Ways and Means Committee, and that is what they approved to go forward to the full council. However, in working on that to update the items that we had discussed, also came to my attention that the Maha Marshall Amateur Hockey Association had an agreement with Marshall for the ice time that was different than what I had in what I proposed or brought towards to the Ways and Means Committee. So I needed to update that, so I created draft number 2 to differentiate between the two and the changes. The changes was the $65 an hour ice time for the first 450 hours, and then it goes to $40 thereafter. Before, what draft one came in at was $75 and then $65, but this agreement came to me later, like I had said. The other thing that the Ways and Means Committee asked me to provide was a memo from our engineering department further explaining the surface water fees that were added into the fees resolution.
Okay. Thank you, Carla. Any input from the Ways and Means Committee?
I say we did go through this, and Carla, I think, pretty well covered everything. At the time, the only real question we had was in regards to the wastewater and number of questions, how that came, how those fees were determined, and was that by comparison or some other means of coming up with the fees? So I think the most of our questions at the time.
Lynn, you have a...
Well, I was just wondering, so we have an agreement with MAHA, a signed agreement that we're going to provide them with ice time at these rates?
I have not been provided with the signed agreement. I asked for the signed agreement, and they provided me with a proposal.
But I mean, what were they buying before from us? What ice time did we have to sell them before?
None.
So
MAHA.
Arena. MAHA owned their own arena.
Right. So yeah. We never had a rate for them before, did we?
No.
So
we subsidized the arena or the hockey.
Right, but we didn't rent them a facility and charge them rent. So where'd they come up with this $65 an hour? I mean, why would we have an agreement to rent it to them if we never had any facility before?
Well, just to clarify, you're exactly right. There was no previous agreement. This is a new agreement, and this was the prior action of the council that addressed just what the fee for MAHA as well as the school.
Okay, so
all you've done is just incorporate what the previous agreed upon amount would be into the fee resolution.
So at some point in the past, we passed an agreement with them that agreed to the $65 a month. Do anybody remember when that was, or?
I think, was that not also MAHA and the school system as well?
That's right. In fact, it was part of the discussion of the joint powers.
So why is the high school at 75 and MAHA at 65? Why are we renting it to MAHA at a lower rate than we're even doing to the high school?
Well, that's
for community services.
That's the previous action. That was part of the joint powers agreement. Scott, I'm not going to put you on the...
Yeah, I don't understand the rationale.
But as far as for the purposes tonight, there was a previous agreement. All Carla has done is just incorporate that into this so we have an accurate 2017 fee resolution.
Well, it'd be nice to see that agreement, what was said and what was agreed upon.
I've got a copy of the proposal, but I don't have a copy of the final.
That was given to us, Senator?
Yes, it was. And in fact, I'm going to look to you, Scott, that maybe you could provide that, not tonight, but at a future point. That was acted on by the school board, and that was acted on by the city council.
Okay.
And I want to say that the time frame to look at would be that March, April. Perhaps Tom or Jane, you could help with the research on that, too.
Right. But I guess I have real concerns that if we're renting it to MAHA at a lower rate than the high school, that just doesn't make sense to me.
Mr. Mayor, I think I can address that to some degree. In the past, when MAHA owned the arena and we went from just playing Minnesota amateur hockey and we went to the Minnesota State High School League, high school games, both the boys varsity and girls varsity, the school paid a certain amount back to MAHA, because then that money, the high school parents still paid the same amount to be in the association or to have their kids play hockey, and they used the additional funds from the high school to subsidize the beginner programs to help families kind of scholarship to get younger players into playing hockey and to start to offset some of the cost to initiate them into the game. So the high school actually is used to paying time before the, when MAHA was actually running the facility. So, I mean, I can't speak to the negotiations that went to the high school, but that was part of the formula for high school sports and covering the costs.
Okay, other questions?
When would we review this rate again then? I mean, it says the rates are under review or something, or and they're going to have a new two-year agreement or something? Isn't that what's said here?
This is good for a two-year then discussion with appropriate parties to set reasonable pricing going forward. That's what the wording is.
As part of that joint powers, right?
Yep.
Okay, other discussion?
The only other thing, I just have a comment under the Aquatic Center. It says $100 per hour plus, I think it says, depends upon where you put the decimal, it has 3000 per person, dollars per person. I think we just need to clean it. I think that means $3 per person. Just wanted you all to know that I did study. No, I don't.
What page is that on, please? Do you have a page there? No? Okay.
I did this late last night. You're lucky as a week.
Okay. So we'll note that.
Okay.
And thank you, Larry, for catching that. any other questions?
I'll move the recommendation of the second draft for fees resolution.
Motion by Larry, is there a second?
I will second that.
Seconded by John. Discussion? If there's no discussion, we'll move to a vote. Motion passes. Agenda item number 23. Agenda item number 23, consider the approval of temporary on sale of liquor license for Southwest Minnesota State University. Any questions on this? I'd entertain a motion.
So moved. Second.
Motion by John, seconded by Larry. Discussion? If not, we'll move to a vote. Motion passes. We'll note the abstention. Agenda item number 24. Commission Boardly reports. From my part, the Fire Relief Association meets quarterly, so there's no report tonight. Regional Development Commission had their monthly meeting this past Thursday evening, which that was the same time as the grand opening at the Red Baron Arena, so I was not in attendance at the Regional Development Commission meeting. Craig?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The Library Board met last night or yesterday evening, and discussed and approved a number of policy updates, changes, some discussions about unattended children drop-offs, cleaning up some of the other the position descriptions and staffing, and getting prepared to work with our budget stuff. So it's been pretty busy. But I think, again, the library is moving forward quite well. She's kind of changing some of the traditional arrangements in there and just making it a lot more comfortable and in a better place to, a better experience for people coming in there. And then also there's been quite a bit of discussion about, some of the collections and moving that around, and along with the kind of the revisiting and reorganizing of both the foundation and the Friends, and getting their articles of incorporation kind of cleaned up and back on track as a nonprofit. So a lot of the administrative pieces are really coming into place, and I think that everything has been pretty positive. So hopefully I think we're gonna do a lot better job working through our budget piece this year.
Okay, thank you, Craig. Anything else? Larry?
Personnel met last Friday, and we went over that already this evening. Today, the Southwest Minnesota Sports Center met. The grand opening was a huge success. Figured about 1,500 people attended that. Had 75 skaters on the ice during that event, and we had all those people out there skating, and no one was actually hurt, which was pretty impressive. We had several dignitaries here, including Don Luciano from the Gophers, and he was super impressed, and he would like to bring some type of an exhibition here sometime in the near future. Scheduling is about 75% done. as far as the facility there and all the other facilities within the city. Hopefully that will be online by October 1st, and then anybody that has any requests to lease or rent some of the facilities here in town can go through that website and get that done. The first girls hockey game, I think, is scheduled for like November 18th. Prior to that, there will be some Bantam tournaments and that there, but that will be the first high school game, November 18th. So that's why we really got to get this thing up and running and not the second guess and everything that we're doing there. Let me end my report.
Okay. Glenn?
I have none.
John?
Utilities did meet on the 31st, and they really reviewed, and from their discussion on the electrical and water rates, the cost of service study, and there will be a public meeting on that that's scheduled. I don't recall the exact date right now. One of the items that in recommendation in the cost of service study looks like about a 16% decrease in the cost of electrical that is going to be coming in. There will be somewhat of a water increase, but definitely a nice improvement in the electrical. A couple of other things. They did do some of their strategic planning, but one of the other actions that was taken is over about the next approximate 5-year time frame. The street lighting will be retrofitted with LED lighting, and it'll be a change. You see kind of the gold or glow to it now, or kind of orange glow, will become a more of a white light. You see what's out at the college along State Street in that area is all LED lighting, and that's going to be going citywide over about the next 5 years, and a considerable savings in maintenance over doing that to switch from the number of times they need a bucket truck up to either fix or replace a bulb to LED lighting that's in the 10-20 year lifetime of the bulb. So it will be a significant savings over the years. And since that's part of our payment in lieu of taxes, there's a cost in there. Eventually the city will be seeing some savings from that as well. So I think that's about it. Oh, we at Ways and Means, we did have Ways and Means, and we've acted on that tonight. So.
Thank you, John. David?
The Police Advisory Board met last Wednesday to review the procedures for filling a pending vacancy.
And Elaine?
The Community Service Advisory Board met last week under the directorship of our new director, Scott. And so we reviewed some things that we're looking at in the future. And then tomorrow, there will be a meeting of the Adult Community Center Commission. As I told you a couple of weeks ago, they are asking for quite an additional increase to their budget, and then I know that we'll discussing that further.
Yeah, and to that point, I think that also, you know, we'll go through the Community Services Division. That is really the umbrella that will be presented.
For the adult?
That's right.
Okay.
That's right. So that doesn't come separately. So.
Oh, okay.
Okay, agenda item number 25, council member individual items. Craig?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Mayor. I do have a couple. One, I want to just thank and commend the community services staff for all the efforts that they put into making the tripper training last month on the 24th a big success. The Red Baron Arena and Expo was a huge hit. Alex did an awesome job out there with IT, and the EPA folks from Washington told me that that's the first one they've done that hasn't had any video audio issues, so they were pretty impressed. Good job to those folks. And then I want to thank Glenn and the engineering department for their assist in working through a repeat MS4 stormwater issue, some illicit discharge stuff. And then Glenn and I spoke a little bit earlier, and I think everybody that attended the Red Baron Arena and Expo open house realizes that we need to really focus on some parking here before the hockey season starts. So we've had some conversations, and I know that's in the works, and even if it's temporary to begin with, we really need to look at that, because that's...
That may include a walkway between the high school property and the...
Yes. So,
very good. Yeah, and hopefully maybe we... Some other options to it. Just it is really grossly short. Getting a little pushback because we enforce our parking regs on other developments, and we need to make sure we do it right for ourselves.
Okay, Larry.
A couple of things. People are quite happy when they go down East College Drive now, on their way out to college, whatever. They can actually drive down there without getting a wheel alignment or losing tires, whatever. And the other thing is I still have people contacting me on the Saratoga bike path. They're concerned that we're not going to get that taken care of this fall, so that next spring it'll all be weeds and so forth again.
And Glenn, we'll let you address that when we get to you.
Thanks.
Okay. Glenn?
I have none.
John?
None.
David?
Just a note from the Coalition of Greater Minnesota Cities. We had a conference call meeting last week and adopted a recommendation to pursue what I'll call a more aggressive transportation policy in terms of what we be advocating before the legislature. I can give you the details if you'd like, but it's a recognition that the previous approaches really haven't been fruitful for anybody, and it's both... But the idea that this will better promote the long-term interests of the member cities of the coalition, but also maybe provide an example that breaks some of the gridlock and maybe get something resolved. So more on that to come.
Annie Lane.
I just wanted to mention that MMU approached me a while back and asked if I would host a TV series that they're doing regarding the work that they accomplished in 2015. And that is going to be about a six session program well over some time. They haven't set all that up yet. And I find it's really, really interesting. A couple of weeks ago, a couple of the staff took us out on the route from Marshall to the Sanus aquifer, and so we were driving along where the pipeline is, and so we really saw some interesting country, and also how important it is that we continue to find water sources for Marshall, because we always have been short because of the glacier activity way back in prehistory. And so it was very interesting to see how the MMU has had the vision and the ability to go ahead and find additional aquifers. So Marshall has three wells out of that aquifer. And of course, that's maybe old news, but it was very interesting, and we will continue to do some more programming about MMU.
Thank you, Elaine. Let me just make a brief comment about the 9/11 memorial event this past Sunday. Very well attended, very well organized. And, you know, a lot of thanks probably goes to Kathy Lee as well as the other participants in the program, as well as our fire department, law enforcement that were all involved. So very, very nice program. I know a number of you were in attendance there, but this is the 15th anniversary, of course, of the 9/11 event, and the 5th anniversary of the dedication of Memorial Park. So it's very nice to see the community come out and really commemorate that event at this very meaningful park. With that, let's move on to agenda item number 26. Staff reports, Nick.
Thank you, Mayor. A lot of the things you guys touched on, I was going to say, was at the Red Baron Arena grand opening. That was absolutely wonderful. I heard that Schwann's gave out some 2,000-plus slices of pizza, and they all gone. All the ice cream was gone. I was actually in line after at the end to get a slice of pizza.
I was right in front of him. Back out.
The mayor got his, and I went up to say, some more, please. And they said, well, we're out. So I was that guy that was the first one that they were out of pizza with, which was great to hear. It's great to hear that they got rid of everything they had. It was a wonderful grand opening. Like I said, yeah, about 1,500 people there. Just a lot of good traffic going through there. The Alex from Studio One put together a video of the 9/11 ceremony, which is on the City of Marshall's website. If you go on the website, I believe the link's on the right-hand side of the page. So if anybody wants to view that wasn't able to make it, certainly can. And then touching on MMU's LED project, that's going to be. I've been impressed with MMU's progressiveness towards doing those kind of changeouts, burying all their electrical lines, and then also moving forward with an LED project. It's just nice to see that sort of proactive thinking about things. With that, that's all I have.
Okay. Questions for Nicholas? Glenn?
Thank you, Mayor and Council. Just do some brief synopsis of construction projects. The project on B Street and Lion Street and Jean Street is nearing completion for this year. The first lift of asphalt was placed, the concrete work is done, and the only item left, which is a little controversial right now, is the finished work of the black dirt and seating. It seems to be one of the items it's really the only thing that you see on the surface when you get done with the project, and we'll be working with the contractor tomorrow morning to try to resolve those issues with the property owners and the black dirt requirements. A Street, as you know, was completed last year except for the last asphalt surface lift. That'll be done probably by next week for the final lift on A Street, but the new project from this year, of course, will wait for next year for the final lift of asphalt. So there's some transition areas next to the handicapped ramps and things like that they'll put little wedges on, but essentially that'll be complete next year for the final lift of asphalt. The work on South 2nd Street, we need to get going to get that completed. The gravel is going on and it'll take off once the gravel is in. The curb and gutter work has to be done on the entire project area and then the asphalt work. So the contractor is working diligently to get that done, but it is mid-September and we need to get that concrete work in so we can get the first lift of asphalt done in that area as well. We touched base on the project at the concessions building. The sports center is still not 100% complete. The construction manager has given what's called an ultimatum for the contractors to get their work done. Otherwise, the next step would be to hire another contractor to finish the work and reduce the existing contracts by the amount that we have to complete. So that one's underway as well. The Saratoga Street project has got some concrete issues that have to be taken care of, and we're trying to get the dirt work and finish work done on that project as well. The issue there, of course, has been the additional rain that we've received over the last month and a half, but the contractor will be coming in to get that area filled in, I'll call it, for the black dirt and reseeded. The deadline date for seeding of that is the 20th of September, which is a week from today, if we're going to do final seeding. If it's not done by then, it will be dormant seeding, which I'd just soon not do at this point in time. But we're working with both our consultant and the contractor to get that work done. We're in the final stages of the design for the bike path project that was included under the legacy grant. We got tentative approval from the railroad to proceed with the final design of the crossing at the railroad tracks. So we hopefully that will be done and ready for council approval and authorization on our next council meeting. If you have any other questions, I'd certainly take them.
Any questions for Glenn? Thank you, Glenn. Dennis?
Thank you, Mayor and Council. A considerable amount of time has been dealing with the sponsorship agreements that have been acted upon and that are currently pending. Also, at Council's request, there has been discussion about significant number of change orders related to the Red Baron Arena and Expo. Scott and people from his office and Glenn and I, Nick and the construction manager and the architect had a rather lengthy meeting a week or two ago to discuss the 108 change orders that had been proposed, some canceled, some approved, and there is a current list that is being reviewed really regarding some causation issues for change orders. You know, who requested them, why did they occur, unforeseen circumstances. That's all under review. There will be a report hopefully coming. I'm hopeful next meeting or the meeting after that, but we're not ignoring the requests of council. There's significant time being delegated to that. Thank you.
Okay. Question for Dennis? Not, then we'll move on to agenda item number 29, the pending agenda items. Any questions about the pending agenda items? Not, agenda item number 30, information items, including the building permits, which brings us then to agenda item number 31, the listing of upcoming meetings. And then finally, the consideration to adjourn this meeting. Is there a motion to adjourn?
I'd do that.
Motion by Larry, is there a second? Seconded by David to adjourn discussion. If not, we'll move to a vote. The motion does pass. We will now give a couple minutes to allow the council then to enter electronically into our budget workshop meeting that will be held immediately now. So